Welcome to the series of interviews of women in science, organized by the International Union of Crystallography. Today we are with Dr. Julia Contreras-García, president of the organization Women in High Pressure. Hi Julia, tell me a little bit about yourself. Who are you and what is your field of research?
Hi, so especially within crystallography, my field of research is focused on the analysis of electron density. So we try to understand the electron density and derived fields to comprehend a chemical bond. And from there, especially lately, we try to derive macroscopic properties. So for example, in the last years, we've been focusing in describing superconductivity and predicting critical temperature, which is a pretty difficult property to predict, very expensive. So we're trying to figure out non-expensive methods to derive it from the electron density and simple calculations in general.
And can you tell us a little bit about the Women Under High Pressure group? I understand that you were the founder. Can you tell us how it was first formed?
So that is that was an interesting foundation, I would say. So it was many years ago. This sounds like an old story, but it is not so old. So basically, I work a lot also in the within the high pressure field, and there is the European High Pressure Committee, and basically the only woman that was present in the committee was leaving, and only men were proposed to take over. Somebody realized during the General Assembly and said that other women should be proposed, and basically the reaction on the floor was just silence. And later on we were told, when discussing with people, that basically no names were proposed because there were no women in the community. Then that night we went for drinks, and with some friends, with Shanti Dinyar and Miriam Peña, we basically were very angry, so we decided that we had to take action, and basically we decided to make an online database so that there would be no longer possible to say that there are no women in the field.
And can you tell us how the group has evolved ever since?
So it has had several stages, I would say. So at the beginning we had the database. Then, especially thanks to Miriam, she got very active during conferences in organizing so different meetings where we would discuss topics related to women in science, and we also made t-shirts. So if you've seen around the Women in Crystallography t-shirts, that was us. And if you haven't seen them, then probably you should look for them in the next conference. So that would be stage number two, I would say, where it got basically known beyond the database. And very recently, we have finally formalized it. So we have signed it as an association, proper association, and with president, secretary, blah blah blah, and we are now. So I guess the old team has founded the association, but the aim is that the new generations take over, and that's what they are doing right now. So they have made a new and updated, not outdated like probably the one I did, web page and so on. So I would say it's very much alive.
And what about the committee for parity that happened in the 2018 ECA meeting? Can you talk to us a little bit about that?
True, that's, I would say, a sub-stage of stage two. So that's also another part where action was taken. That was during the ICA meeting in Oviedo. One of the organizers, Laura Roses, who is a friend of mine, she was in the organization, and she asked me to be in charge of somehow supervising parity within the conference, which I have to say, at the beginning I was completely lost. I didn't know what to do, so I guess I had the same answer as all scientists. I went into the literature. So I read some articles on parity and conferences, and there was one who actually really piqued my attention about how to promote parity in committees and so. So based on this article, we elaborated a set of rules that were applied for that ECA meeting, where basically the people organizing the symposia had to come up with a number of names for the plenary, for the invited conferences, where there was a statistical representation, a gender statistical representation. So for that we had to do statistics, and the conference organizers ever since have to keep statistics on that, which actually already is a very good, measure on its own, because it forces the organizers to think about it when they're making the invitations. We did some backup plan also in case of those fields where it was very difficult to find women. They could actually write a report on how they were not able to make it. So I think it was very much adapted into the situation, so that it had a very general welcome by the community. So, and I believe it has now been adopted permanently.
Yes, you have a website, I understand. We can see in your websites that there are a few numbers coming from two surveys in 2016 and 2019. What would you say are the main lessons that you learned from those data?
Indeed. So these surveys were another of the actions that the media promoted during conferences. So the data were collected at the conferences. We had a stand where actually, so it was also a very nice event in the sense that people were just volunteering to stay at the stand, selling the t-shirts and making the service. I guess no surprises. Everybody in their departments had basically a glass, how do you call it? So basically there were less and less women as who went on in the career. And so I guess that was for me the saddest conclusion, that it's these numbers reflect every day in our environment.
Is there anything else about the website that you would like to highlight or to invite people to go look at?
Well, to begin with, to sign up. So obviously this database, we keep it with the people who write to us wanting to belong to that website. I would say that it has been extremely useful ever since the committee has way more women participation. I believe by now it's like 30%. It has been also, we have also kept numbers on the, so there are awards associated to high pressure, and it has also increased from the women participation. And what I would like to, so that is the effect. As a matter of fact, I have also, when speaking to colleagues who have organized conferences, they actually told me that they now use the website to look for their the people they will invite. So I want to believe that it has been helpful, that it has been an action that has had consequences. And but it can have more, and I think that probably as one evolves in her career, you realize to which extent this applies to all women in science, which probably I was not aware when I was a student. And I think this also reflects in the webpage. We have many women professors and we don't have so many students and postdocs. So students and postdocs, what I would highlight is you should sign up.
Well, thank you very much, Julia, for answering our questions. Is there any last thing you would like to say to women going inside the field of high pressures?
So, probably, again, you will become aware probably with age that these biases exist, that we all have them. Even if you think you're very lucky and you've never gone through discrimination, I'm pretty sure you have. So it's better to be aware of it, to know that you belong to a community, and the first way of actually belonging to it is signing up. So thank you very much for this interview.
Thank you.
Bye.